All right. Hello, everyone. Wonderful to be with you. Wonderful to be here taping this video. Friday night, what is it, August the... Is it the 27th or is it the 28th? It's the 28th today. We're still here, right? We're still here. I don't know if that's wonderful or not. But I feel great, even though my world is absolutely crumbling. Everything is crumbling around me. Flying high here, glass is half full, and I'll just impart this encouragement to everyone. You know, it's a wonderful time. We're heading into the storm. As a matter of fact, it was a Hurricane Katrina was about 10 years ago today, right? The most devastating storm really to ever strike the United States and hardly almost anywhere in the world. It was so extraordinary. Okay. So, we're entering into this time, and I've said it's going to be an extraordinary time, but it can be an extraordinarily great time. This is what we're looking for. And I have the tools. I know what the tools are. I know what the tools are. And just to hear this is exciting. Just be able to explain this is just exciting. I said in the last video that Donald Trump is John the Baptist. Okay, great title. Some people took offense at it. I lost like a 4 subscribers and got a thumbs down on it, which is very rare. And, you know, let me just say that the archetype of a John the Baptist is an archetype, which means someone who disrupts the overwhelming narrative of a culture, of a world, that people get locked into a narrative and they feel it's a script, and they feel they have to, this is their destiny. They must go along this path. Somebody comes along and says, no. There's another path. I like this one better. This one's much better. Much better, much better. You know? And, what? People are saying, what? And what John the Baptist did in ancient times was he disrupted the narrative of Judea. What happened? People were in motion. People were on their feet. They're thinking, hey, wait a minute, you know. They felt something great was going to happen. They didn't know what. They said, we're about ready to shift narratives here. This is what John the Baptist did. Same thing that Trump's doing. It is an archetype where you say, wait a minute, you know, there's another narrative. You know, you don't have to agree with this narrative. You don't have to be, you know, and I mean, John the Baptist was abrasive. He was very abrasive. He's very bellicose. He was, you know, he offended many people. Really? He wasn't, you know, the many people said, oh, that terrible John the Baptist. He's out there preaching anti-establishment, different narrative, you know, it's awful. Everybody's leaving their families, going to get baptized. This is horrible. There's a lot of negativity toward John the Baptist, actually. But he kept doing it. Okay. What happened? A new narrative came into the picture, didn't it, with Jesus Christ? A new narrative came in the picture. But people were ready for a new narrative. They say, hey, wait a minute. We're not stuck with this old narrative. We don't have to be stuck with it. Let's wash away the narrative, wash away our sins. Let's wash away the old narrative, and let's get a better narrative going. Okay? And this is what we're doing here. Let's get a better narrative going. Because the one that we have been under the spell of is a hideous narrative, actually. So, you know, some people missed the meta message of it all. The meta message, there's something bigger at stake here, way, way, way bigger, and it's called your destiny, and it's called your future, your destiny. That's what's at stake. And we had better get out of that PC culture, which I call pharmaceutical culture. It's way more than PC culture. People don't understand how severe it is. I've gone over and over and over this. It actually comes from extraterrestrials. It's cosmic corporate culture. And it is the attempt to convince us that mortal mind is true. And that's all there is. Not only is mortal mind true and real, it's reality, but it's the only reality there is. This is what they want. And this is a disaster. So hopefully people can hear this and say, now, wait a minute, okay, let's get wise about the situation. Let's get wise about it. Let's look at it in a spiritual way. I say all politics are spiritual politics. All politics are spiritual politics. They really are. And we have this situation here where suddenly a wrench has been thrown into the whole narrative. A monkey wrench has been thrown into it. It doesn't matter who throws the wrench. The fact that what's important is that the wrench is thrown. I'll take anybody throwing it, okay? So it doesn't, you know, don't worry. Don't get hung up on anything except to say, wow, good thing a wrench has been thrown into the narrative now. That's great. That's great. Because this PC culture is worse than anybody really knows, and I've been trying to bring this up, bring it up, bring it up, bring it up. And, you know, we have to realize that there's something wrong with it. There's some people, are those who are under the spell of it, are seriously deranged. Seriously deranged. They're extreme projectionists. They project their own derangement upon anyone who doesn't agree with them and then demonizes them like this. And it's just extraordinary what's happening. But I've been warning that this has been happening. I've known that my whole life that this is going to get severe to the breaking point. A lot of people are at breaking points right now in this world, including in my own relatives, etc., etc., etc. They're at the breaking point because their spirit really doesn't like what's going on. And yet their mind has been brainwashed into, well, not their mind, but the quote, mortal mind. They've been brainwashed into thinking that, you know, mortal mind is real. It's the only reality. We have to somehow come to accept this. This is causing a depression in people. It is causing, well, it's causing a dissociation, as it were, a mental conflict. Not even mental conflict, a spiritual conflict. It's causing a spiritual conflict. And it's getting a very, very bad crisis, I would say, crisis. Now, nobody knows that knows me, has any in the family and social life, has the slightest clue that I know anything about anything. They think I'm just a complete idiot. This is the problem. You know, the mortal mind thinks that those who know about eternal life are just complete idiots. Because mortal mind says, well, there is no spirit. What are you talking about? No, that's just a projection. They think that eternal life is just a projection. And they're battling against that projection. But in doing so, they end up projecting all their own craziness, you know, onto others who believe in spirit, you know. It's really something. And, you know, I've dug into this narrative enough right now. I've dug into it. I don't know if I'll do any more. Maybe, you know, you never know what I'm going to do. But the Trump narrative, for instance, I dug into it. And I realize now just how severe the projection is. You know, making a straw man that doesn't really fit at all what the person is. Doesn't really at all. It's extraordinary. So we can see the sickness of society, you know, coming, being unveiled right now. This is the apocalypse. The sickness of our society is being veiled. We're very sick. I have been preaching this endlessly. It almost feels like endlessly. This society is an extraordinarily sick society, culture. And we're going down the tubes. And this is, and people feel it. So, you know, we've got to do something. But, okay. So, what do we do? This is the question. Well, we're still standing. That's the most important thing. Congratulations to everybody who has made it this far. It's extraordinarily great effort to make it this far. August 28th. Some people think that the rapture may be today or tomorrow, sort of like that. Okay, well, the intensity sure here, isn't it? But yesterday I was driving. I said, I'm ready to go, actually. It's not a problem. Should there be one, right? An ascension or something. But most people, you ask them, they know something big's going to happen soon. When, they don't know, but soon. Okay. So, where I'm at here, where the videos are at and all this is I have been made aware of that there's this high practice, actually. And the real application of that, the pragmatic application of it, you could say, it could be applied this way, is if there were some great teachers in the world, centers of absolute knowing of eternal life, centers of pure realization of eternal life, knowing it's the only life there is, total acceptance of it, if there were such, This tool enables us to actually be in their presence. This is the amazing, super pragmatic application of this practice, which I call imitating abstraction. I called it also canceling out concepts as an initial way I talked about canceling out concepts. But you could even say it's imitating pure abstraction. But another way to look at it is, it would enable us to stay on the train, so to speak. If the driver is one who knows eternal life, stay on that train. Get on the train and stay on it. This is a tremendous pragmatic application of this practice. And so today I was trying this out and finding out, oh my gosh, this is it. Because it enables us to deal with the continuity problem without panicking or fleeing. And what we do is we co-opt the negative part of it by embracing it together with the positive. So they're both there. Yes, I know that this is really it. Yes, I'm absolutely certain that this is really it, and I'm absolutely certain that this is not really it. Okay. And I've explained in many videos now this practice. So we will get into it, should God willing here, that we'll get into it a little more. But when something wonderful happens, initially you think this is great, oh my gosh, but then you feel like my elation is I don't know how to handle my elation, and I don't not sure how to function, and inevitably doubt, fear creeps in, then doubt in the mind, and before you know it, you're sliding away and jumping off the train at the next station. You're backsliding. Jesus talked about that in the parable of the sower, talking about the temporary enthusiasm. He said some seeds of the sower go on bare stone, and the birds come down and eat them. And some go in shallow soil, and initially they shoot up real fast, and then the heat of the sun, they just wilt like that. And others, they grow among weeds, and the weeds choke them out. And some, they grow upon open soil, deep open soil, and they turn into a great, you know, fruitful plant. The temporary enthusiasm, elation, is the one with the soil is not deep enough. And this ends up them, he talks about it, he explains, says, well, some will come to a teacher and say, oh, this is great, and for a while they're just super enthusiastic, and later on, he says, you'll see them, they backslide, they go away, and later on, they're like severely criticizing the teacher, just tearing into him. You know, they completely go against us, the continuity fear has bit them and pulled them down. So everyone has this extraordinarily severe problem. It's called the continuity fear. And we have to accept this and realize that this is a vicious problem we have. However, we have the remedy for it here. We really have the remedy for it. And I can express this and share it and teach it. Absolutely. I've taught myself it. So, for example, let me use an example of Ramana Maharshi. I feel that maybe Ramana Maharshi is going to make an appearance in the world. I really do. There's a feeling of that. And so let's say I see Ramana Maharshi. I told you I saw a lookalike, a doppelganger of Ramana Maharshi in a gas station. And I said, oh my gosh, what am I going to do? Is that, what if that's him? What if that's him? I didn't panic. I said, well, okay, I'll just look. I felt like I had the tools to deal with something like this. So it would be an elation for me. I mean, if Ramana Maharshi was here, it would be like an extraordinary elation. You couldn't hardly believe your great good fortune. You just feel like your ship has finally come in. That kind of feeling. Like, wow, I'm going to make it. This is just awesome. Just beyond awesome. It's immeasurably, I'm just completely elated. You know, this would be my experience of it. However, that's not how I would react. Okay? So, hear this, please. For your own edification, I would say, okay. So this is absolutely, I'm absolutely certain that this is awesomely great news, and I'm absolutely certain that this is not awesomely great news. And I would begin practicing this way. Whatever positive came up, I would state it, and then I'd state the opposite, or I'd put it in the negative form. It both is and is not. It both is and is not. It both is and is not. And I would just quietly sit there And I would just ferociously determined to use my will, full stop in the wow of this, saying, yeah, this is what I've been waiting for, and this is not what I've been waiting for. This is absolutely what I've been hoping for, and it's absolutely not what I've been hoping for. I am absolutely certain that this is it, and I'm absolutely certain that this is not it. So I would actually practice this practice. Now, this is extraordinary, because most people say, oh my gosh, this opportunity is the greatest opportunity. I've got to just jump out, you know, just go with the elation. I say, no, I'm not going to go with that at all. I'm going to stay centered in the wow, in this neutral mode, and I'm going to use my mind to practice, and I'm going to acknowledge the elation, and I'm going to acknowledge the trepidation, and I'm going to put them in one acknowledgement, right here, right now. And what this does is short circuits the fear. It's because you're embracing it and acknowledging it, and you're saying, because in your mind you say, wait a minute, this is really it? And another part of you is saying, whoa, no, this isn't it. And you cannot disassociate the two. So you cure the disassociation that's going on by actually practicing under this, in this situation, this wonderful practice of imitating abstraction is a way, one way to put it. But it is. Immediately, you will feel calmed down and centered. And you have to trust the teacher. They know exactly what you're doing. No, this is important. This is important. All three teachers that I've been working with, Jesus, Longchenpa, and Ramana Maharshi, have all very strongly indicated that this practice is the right practice and what is indicated. So they're not going to abandon you because, hey, wait, this is going to, hey, you know, wait a minute, I came here and, you know, I want you to be chanting and yelling and you should be thrilled, elated. How come you're sitting there quietly? You know, what is that? No, they won't. I trust they're not going to do that. I have to trust it. Because they're going to say, wow, there's a great disciple right there. One that has listened to the Holy Spirit and has got it. And they are taking care of business of making sure that they're centered in the wow, and they're full stop in the wow. They're doing the full stop on the wow, which is essential. They're managing their success, and they're going to say, ah, that's one that is truly going to be liberated. Great. So if someone comes up and says, hi, I'm Ramana Maharshi, I'll say, yes, this absolutely is. I'm absolutely certain that this is Ramana Maharshi, and I'm absolutely certain that this is not Ramana Maharshi. Okay? I would practice like that. Yes, I am both absolutely certain. I am both absolutely certain that this is Ramana Maharshi, and I am absolutely certain that this is not Ramana Maharshi. I am absolutely certain that this is what I really want, and I'm absolutely certain that this is not what I really want. And I would put those together and embrace them as one statement, not fighting with one another, not dissociated or in conflict with one another, but I have a positive acceptance towards both, equal positive acceptance to both. You get this? You say, wow. I'm absolutely certain my ship has finally come in, and I'm absolutely certain that my ship has not finally come in. And give both positive, equal value to you, okay? Don't try to judge and favor one or the other, because what we're trying to do here is we're trying to make sure we don't start dissociating, because once dissociation starts happening, you may keep elation for a while, but after a while you're going to start feeling too unstable, and the continuity fear is going to bite you, and you're going to wither. Your positive outlook is going to wither away. You might say, wow, I'm absolutely certain that this situation is making a profound impact on me. And I'm absolutely certain that this situation is not making a profound effect upon me. Now, you see what this does is it tempers the elation, or you just kind of feel, I feel kind of neutral about this. I feel kind of neutral. Now, I have said before many times that reality does not need we do not need to judge for it. We just need to make sure we don't judge against it, because reality is what is. It is what's real. It's present. It's presence. It's truth. So it's there for us. So it doesn't need our approval, our accept, you know, say, oh yeah, I judge that you're there for me. No, it's always there for us. So we don't need to judge for truth. We just make sure we don't backslide and disassociate from it. Okay? That's all that's required. So it's enough to be calm in a neutral mode in such a situation, and full stop in the wow. And so your thoughts are not racing. I mean, I feel like my emotions are calm, my thoughts are calm, because I know how to do this practice. So I'm not, you know, so your focus then is on maintaining this wow, okay? Being comfortable with this wow. So this tool that we have literally, it will enable us to be in the presence of great teachers. This has been my goal in life. Literally will enable us to be in the presence of great teachers. We don't lose our minds. And this is what they're looking for. Okay, great teachers are looking for those who will not lose their balance or equilibrium in their presence. That's what they are looking for. And it, God knows it's far and few between. Okay, far and few between know how to do this. Because they cannot contact somebody directly who will lose their equilibrium, because that will cause them to delay their salvation, which is the last thing they want. So their hands are tied in that way. Their hands are tied, so we want to untie their hands. You see, we're doing a great favor for them, great help for them here by untying their hands. And they say, you know, hey, we know how to practice, we know how to practice in the right way, effective way, so you can contact us directly, and we can be helped directly by you, and it's not going to cause us to come unglued. Now, this isn't to say that it would be entirely smooth. See, of course not. I mean, but you know, it's a challenge. It's a challenge. You know, and I feel up to it. I feel up to it. So you just forget about the teacher and just say, you know, this is the greatest. I'm absolutely certain that this is the greatest moment in my life. And I'm also absolutely certain that this is not the greatest moment of my life. And what do I feel? I feel this calm descending upon me when I say this. It's a miracle. This practice is a miraculous practice, actually. And it's a practice that nobody would really think of in terms of a practice and applying it in this way, okay? It would never occur to us. I mean, which is why we haven't done it. The Holy Spirit, you know, there had to be help. I had to get help from the Holy Spirit and from the teachers to actually try this. It just seems like, how could this be helpful at all? But it is. It's extraordinarily helpful. And we say, wow, this is really, absolutely, this, I'm certain that this is what reason wants for me. And I'm also absolutely not certain that this is what reason wants for me. I'm both absolutely certain that this is the work of the Holy Spirit for me. And I'm also absolutely not certain that this is the Holy Spirit's work for me. I'm both absolutely certain that this is Ramana Maharshi, and I'm also absolutely certain that this is not Ramana Maharshi. For example, using this as an example. I'm absolutely certain that this is extraordinarily great good fortune for me, and I'm also absolutely certain that this is not extraordinarily great fortune for me. Okay, now who would ever think that this is how you're supposed to react to in the presence of a great teacher? Who would ever even think such a thing? But for me, I feel I know that it is. This is the way. Because I can feel just this very self-contained. I feel very self-contained and not flustered, very calm, very centered, just thinking about the situation. Whereas before, I become unglued. When I think about such a thing, I become unglued with elation. Now, no such thing is happening at all. I am both absolutely certain, I'm both absolutely convinced now of eternal life, and I'm also absolutely not convinced of eternal life. See, I'm both absolutely convinced of eternal life and absolutely not convinced of eternal life. And I'm saying both of these with equal positivity. I'm not judging between them at all. No judgment. We could say, this is, I know this is absolutely the great guru himself, and I know that this is absolutely not the great guru himself. Now, only the great teachers would recommend we practice this way, because they're absolutely certain of their own beingness, own truth, eternal lifeness. Okay, so when we state that I'm absolutely certain that this is the great guru, and I'm absolutely certain that this is not the great guru, they are not upset, irritated, angry, undermined, disappointed, you know, flustered, shaken up. You don't rock their boat at all by doing that. You don't rock it in the slightest way. Because they don't need our recognition to know that they're eternal life. See, they don't need, reality doesn't need recognition that it's real. It doesn't need recognition that it's real. It is real. It doesn't need recognition that it's real. That's not what's required. It's just merely that we just merely need to not judge against it. And by putting this negative together with the positive, you see, without judgment, what it's really just saying is this is just, you know, completely abstract. See, we're not judging against, because we're saying it both is and it isn't. Both is and isn't. That's not a judgment against it. And yet the negative is allowed to express itself there, you see. The fear is given a voice, expression, without passing judgment on it, so you do not retreat. She said, when he was about ready to die, they said, "You're leaving us. This is horrible. It's terrible." And he said, "Shame, shame, shame. No, 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 no. It's impossible that I leave you. How could I leave you? I'm everywhere. I mean, I'm always with you." He said, "In fact, I'll be with you even more now that this body is not an encumbrance." He said, "This body is actually an encumbrance. I'll be much more effective without a body." But he said, "I am absolutely not leaving you. I promise you this." And this is what teachers, all the great teachers say. No, I'm not leaving you at all. I'm with you more than you can possibly know. So how do we know? How are we to put limits on what these teachers can do, what these helpers can do, these great friends of ours can do? Who are we to dictate to them what they can do, can and can't do? They know their eternal life. It's nothing for them to project an appearance if they want to. They know that does not compromise what they are in the slightest bit. So, you know, everything's in play. For them, everything's in play. And I've been having dreams that Ram Maharshi seems to be, I've been interacting with him, and he's been pointing something out, and he pointed out this exercise. He says, this is what you got. This is what you should do. I said, is this right? I think this is right. What do you think? He says, yeah, that's it. You got it. That's all. He said, yeah, you got it. Okay, again, I said, I think this is it, I'm not sure. Is this it? He says, yeah, you got it. You got it right. So if I'm just using this example, Ram Maharshi, it could be Jesus Christ, it could be Longchenpa, it could be other teachers, and we say, okay, I'm absolutely certain that I'm in the presence of Ram Maharshi, and I'm absolutely certain that I am not in the presence of Ram Maharshi. And be very determined to practice this way. Don't think you need to please them. Say, oh, well, no, I really know that I am. And then you stop the practicing. You stop the practicing. Absolutely certain that this is the great guru, and I'm absolutely certain that this is not the great guru. Don't take sides, don't judge. Don't take sides, don't judge. Now, what does it enable us to do? Sit quietly and not panic. Why is that positive? Because we remain in the presence of this great guru. And that's going to, without us definitively saying one way or the other that it's good. You know, I mean, if you sit out in the sun, for instance, and you're sunbathing in the beach, and you say, I'm absolutely sure that I'm going to get a great tan, and I'm also absolutely sure that I'm not going to get a great tan, okay? Now, what's going to happen? You're going to get a great tan, whether you say so or not. Whether we say so or not, okay? So, that's the benefit of it. We just say, well, we acknowledge both the positive and negative reactions to the situation as one without judging it, and say, yes, I'm absolutely certain that I'm going to get a great tan, and I'm absolutely certain that I am not going to get a great tan. So what do? You just sit there, keep sitting there. And just keep this up, keep this up, keep this up. At the end of a couple hours, you know, you still say, I'm absolutely certain that I'm going to get a great tan. I'm absolutely certain that I'm not going to get a great tan. And say, okay, get up and leave. You know, next day you look and, wow, I have a great tan. Okay, I have a great tan. So, just remaining in the presence, whether you agree that you are in the presence or not, you're going to experience the benefits of that, whatever they may be. Like a sun giving tan to us, we get a spiritual tan from a spiritual sun. We get a spiritual tan. So you might say, hey, I know that this is, I'm absolutely certain that this is super beneficial to me, and I'm absolutely certain that this is not super beneficial to me. So you neither get too high or too low. You do not get too high or too low. You stay in this neutral mode. But meanwhile, you're just sitting quietly. You're not panicking. You're not retreating. And you're getting the spiritual tan. This is why it's so beneficial. Now, we might say, well, what's the use? You know, whatever, Ram Maharshi doesn't show up. Keep in mind that our self, our true self, is within us. I experienced this a while ago, where I experienced my true self, my true nature. And I was just so elated that it was too much. I didn't know this practice at that time. I was going towards it. I've been going towards this for a long time. But I wasn't acutely, concretely aware of it. I could have said, yes, I know that I'm in the presence of my true self. I'm absolutely certain that I'm in the presence of my true self right now. And I'm absolutely certain that I am not in the presence of my true self right now. I could have done that, you see. But we do have a true self. And we can become aware of it within us. Everyone has it within them. So even if there's not, if it's not the external expression of this true self, the benefits of this practice are just as great as we can use it to practice when the inner self within us, the true self that is what we truly are. When we become aware of that, we can do this practice too. Same practice. You might say, I know for absolute certainty that this is a great blessing for me, and I also know with absolute certainty that this is not a great blessing for me. So vigorously demand this abstraction. It's not a middle ground. It's a pure abstraction. So you don't try to put them together and say, well, it's a little of this and a little of that. No, you're making absolute statements both ways. And not trying to compromise or find a middle ground between these two statements. Not at all. Okay. I just got something there. Yeah. So in other words, don't seek for the middle of this, as Longchenpa said, or someone said, okay, the excluded middle. Well, what kind of middle is the excluded middle, you see? What he's saying is don't seek for the middle between these statements. Allow the awareness of the excluded middle. What is that? Pure abstraction. Excluded middle? What is that? That in itself is an abstraction, this statement, and the excluded middle. This is itself an abstraction, complete abstraction, isn't it? How can you have an excluded middle? So when we say, yes, I know with absolute certainty that this is a great blessing for me, and I know with absolute certainty that this is not a great blessing for me, we make certain that we do not allow ourselves to be pulled into the middle, but we cherish the excluded middle of this. So in other words, we're not saying, well, it's some halfway point between I am being blessed by this and I am not being blessed by this. No, because then we're trying to judge, find a compromise. No, we're both saying with absolute unequivocal certainty that I am absolutely unequivocally certain that this is a great blessing for me, and I'm absolutely unequivocally certain that this is not a great blessing for me. And we're saying both with positive affirmation, very positive affirmation, not judging at all. So the middle is totally excluded from this. So this is how I see, if it was Longchenpa, this is what I see, what's meant by this, is make certain that you're cherishing the excluded middle, okay? And not getting into trying to find a middle at all. The middle, cherish the fact that the middle is completely excluded from this practice. There's no middle in this practice. It's a practice with an excluded middle, you could say, all right? Now, so we're in serious business here, because I you know, there are people who their relatives are falling apart. This is my situation too. My job is falling apart. Just everything seems to be going to hell. But I say, hey, this is God's opportunity. Man's extremity is God's opportunity. This is what some teachers have said. Man's extremity is God's opportunity. So I look at it as we have a great, great opportunity right now. super opportunity. Why? Because this teaching has been given out now to anyone who wants to use it. And this teaching literally enables us to be in the presence of perfect teachers, the great teachers, the ones who have no doubt whatsoever that the eternal life is the only life there is. There's not a shred of uncertainty. You know, there's no continuity fear in them anymore. The continuity fear has vanished, entirely vanished for them without a trace. We have the spiritual technology to sit in their presence. How about that? As I have said before, that this technology in the world of high tech, you know, material high tech gadgets, is the new low tech. It's very low tech. It's very Stone Age. It's like a gilded Stone Age that they're asking us to accept. Who wants a gilded Stone Age? You know, a gilded caveman experience. What do I put some gild the entrance to the cave? You know, I mean, what is that? So it's all this high tech is extremely low tech. It's Stone Age low tech stuff. It is Stone Age low tech stuff. This, what we're talking about here, is high tech. It's spiritual tech. It's eternal tech. It enables us to sit in the presence of those who have no continuity fear whatsoever about the fact that eternal life is the only life that there is. And this is very, very valuable for us. So we have that technology, which completely trumps the old technology. Completely trumps it. Okay? Unequivocally trumps it. Unequivocally. Without a trace, you know. It doesn't even leave a trace. It's so completely superior that it trumps it without a trace of a remaining. That's how superior it is. Black and white. Absolutely black and white. So this is the heart of it. We don't dwell too much on politics. But I say all politics are spiritual politics, actually, if you look beneath the surface. It all is. So, I mean, you got high tech, you should use it. You got high tech, you should use it. And we should have the opportunity to use it. As I said, it can be, absolutely can be used within your own, the true self that we are. Which, in experiencing it, you experience this like radiant, 360 degree, like a ball. It's like a ball of radiant bliss, a ball of radiant compassion. A ball of radiant gratitude. This is our true self. When we experience this, we can use this practice, immediately use this practice. Don't wait, just do it immediately. I know I'm absolutely certain I'm in the presence of my true self, and I'm absolutely certain I am not in the presence of my true self. So be proactive about it. Don't just be waiting for something to happen with the teacher. You know, if you realize, hey, this is the teacher, then immediately go into this practice saying, hey, I absolutely realize this is teacher, and I absolutely do not realize that this is the teacher. I absolutely realize that this is the teacher. I absolutely realize that this is not the teacher. Go right into it. Don't wait. Don't wait. And you might even say that doing this practice is what attracts the teacher to you. We've always heard that when the student is ready, the teacher appears. Well, how does that happen? Well, when the student does right practice, it attracts the teacher. They're aware of it. It's like a infallible attraction. So in doing this practice, this, you know, is resonating with the great teachers. They're saying, you know, it's like a beacon, a lighthouse. They're saying someone's got their light on, got their lighthouse turned on. I can see it. That's a welcome. I mean, it's a welcome wagon is there. Jesus said, not all who say Jesus, Jesus, Jesus are going to be saved, right? And see, that's not where it's at. You see, I'm absolutely glad that you're here, and I'm absolutely not glad that you're here. I'm absolutely glad for this opportunity, and absolutely not glad for this opportunity. I'm absolutely elated at my good fortune, and absolutely not elated at my good fortune. I'm absolutely elated at this wonderful development, and absolutely not elated at this wonderful development. I absolutely cherish this opportunity and absolutely do not cherish this opportunity. I absolutely cherish this opportunity and absolutely do not cherish this opportunity. So you say, I absolutely cherish, you're nodding yes. I absolutely cherish this great opportunity. And then you say, shake your head this way, I absolutely do not cherish this opportunity. Okay? So what are you doing? Well, what is the body language? It's a cross, isn't it? It's nodding, so it's a vertical and a horizontal. When I saw this great teacher we call Longchenpa in a dream, he had this red cross on his chest, on a shirt. He was wearing a tank top shirt, and it was this vertical red stripe. That's the nodding. Yes, I absolutely cherish this great opportunity. And then the horizontal, and I absolutely do not cherish this great opportunity. Yes and no. Both yes and no. Both yes and no. Yes and no. And I was asking for help, and this is a response to the plea for help. And I said, this is the help that I have for, I'm bringing to you. This is the help. Now, it's taken me 22 months of constant nonstop work to be able to get to this practice and understand it and recognize it and appreciate it and accept it. Very intense 22 months. So yes, I accept that this is all for my well-being, and no, I do not accept that this is all for my well-being. Yes, I absolutely know that this is what is best for me, and I absolutely do not know that this is best for me. I absolutely feel that this is it, and I absolutely do not feel that this is it. I'm absolutely attracted to this, and I'm absolutely not attracted to this. Wonderful night. The crickets are going at it tonight. Or whatever they call those cicadas. 102 today, plus muggy. It was a beautifully hot day. Love it. Best day of the year, I think, so far. This is just fantastic. There's an intensity to a day like this. You can feel the intensity to it. The sun means business today, you know. It's like that. It's intense. I'm going to put some heat on you today, and you're going to feel it. I said, great. Bring the heat. I actually had work today, so I did a lot of work out in the heat, and yeah, God, it was hot. The sky was cobalt blue. Everything was stark relief. I mean, it was just a fabulous day. But also, we're on the brink of fabulous troubles, which means fabulous opportunity for God. So people might say, well, what are you doing with this teacher? Well, I'm not really, I'm just practicing this practice that I know is appropriate. This yes and no practice. Both I am both this and not this. I'm both sure of this and not sure of this. I'm both certain of this and not certain of this. All I'm doing is just practicing that. They say, well, how's that help? Well, you know, it's the same reason you get out in the sun on the beach and you just sit there and without you doing anything, you get a suntan. Same principle, you know. Whatever benefit the teacher has, it doesn't have to be conveyed through words. It's just the sheer presence is going to happen automatically, the way a suntan happens. So I'm not doing anything other than just doing this practice. And people might say, what? You know, huh? You know, we don't have, whoever even thinks about this possibility. I've thought my whole life about this. That's all I've ever thought about is saints, sages, gurus, and being in their presence. I feel this is what I really want. This is what I really want. It's a spiritual sun. I mean, you know, who doesn't love the sun? Well, some people don't like it. I love the sun, being a sun sign. But, you know, the spiritual sun is way better. Way, way, way better, you see. So, you know, enjoying being out in the sun here, it's even more enjoyable to be in the presence of a spiritual sun. You might say, wow, I'm feeling this amazing compassion, and I'm also not feeling this amazing compassion. So when you feel the compassion, you say, in practice, you say, wow, I'm absolutely certain that I'm experiencing tremendous compassion. And I'm also absolutely certain that I am not experiencing tremendous compassion. So this keeps you sitting in the sun. You say, well, you know, like you sit in the sun, well, I'm sure I'm getting a tan, and I'm absolutely sure I'm not getting a tan. You know, I don't really see it. And, of course, the tan usually doesn't show up till the next day so much, right? And then suddenly, oh, my gosh. Now, some people try to nonchalant it. They know they're trying to keep their equilibrium, so they try to nonchalant it. But they don't have this practice. They don't understand this practice. And they get jittery, and their mind starts racing. And how do I do this? How do I do this? The wheels come off. It's a disaster. And people wonder, like, well, how come I never get to see any great teacher? How come I? Well, because the wheels would come off. So we say this practice works with the greatest of great teachers, you know, the greatest of all great teachers. We would just do the same practice. We'd say, yes, I know I'm in the presence of the greatest of all teachers, and I also know that I'm absolutely not in the presence of the greatest teachers. We just practice like that. So we see, we have something to do. We have a practice, and the teacher is saying, right on, right on, right on. Because that you're getting the spiritual tan. They don't want you. You know, they want you to get the spiritual tan. We do too. And people look at you and say, wow. You know how it is in like school when you're young, and there's some people that get some fabulous tan. You know, you look at them and say, oh my gosh, you know, look, their hair is so bleached and they're so tan. And that's just fabulous look, you know. We had that here. Especially in the wintertime, there's the rich kids would go skiing and they'd be up, or they go to Hawaii or whatever, but a lot of times skiing, like they take a day off school and they go 3-4 day, you know, or on the holiday, you know, the various Labor Day, Memorial Day, whatever, they go skiing. Well, Labor Day they wouldn't. I mean, those two they wouldn't because the snow might not be there, but, you know, other days, at Easter they would go, Thanksgiving they would go, Christmas they would go, New Year's they would go, various other holidays, President's Day, whatever. They come back the school, and they'd just be like glowing with this great tan and just looking like, wow. Everybody just say, wow, look at them. I mean, they've been doing something fun, great, you know. And well, just imagine someone with a spiritual tan, people looking at them and just say, wow, you know, where have you been? You know, they're like, what have you been doing? Where'd you get this glow? I mean, where'd you get this inner glow? I mean, this is amazing. So I've always known that there's going to be some technique, some practice we can use, but it was extremely difficult to track it down. You know, I would say, like, if you're in a situation, use the analogy of like you're not hunting, you're on a wildlife binocular. You're trying to see wildlife, safari. You want to see wildlife, and you've been sitting quietly for a long time, and suddenly this animal rustling, and here comes this animal out of the jungle, so to speak, or the bush, and they come into this grassy clearing, and you know, there's a giraffe or there's an elephant there. And you don't like jump up and shriek and start, oh, take pictures, oh, elephant, you're so great, oh my gosh, I've seen an elephant, you know. What you do is you don't try to grab a hold of it at the moment. You just say, hey, you just stay completely calm. Now the elephant can sense this, you're calm, so it will look at you and it will sense it, say, okay, I can just hang out here, nobody's freaking out. So you would say, oh, I'm absolutely certain that this is just great. I'm just thrilled by this, and I'm absolutely certain that I'm not thrilled by this. I'm absolutely elated by this, and I'm absolutely not elated by this. Yes, I'm absolutely elated with this, and yes, I'm absolutely not elated with this. Both, you see. And you'll keep your composure, even though here's this elephant you've been waiting all your life to see. You just say, okay, this is the elephant I've been waiting all my life to see, and this is not the elephant I've been waiting all my life to see. I'm absolutely certain this is the elephant I've been waiting all my life to see, and I'm absolutely certain that this is not the elephant I've been waiting all my life to see. And the elephant would just kind of look and nod its head like this, and I'd say, "Ah, oh, I'm absolutely certain that the elephant approves, and I'm absolutely certain the elephant does not approve." So don't be a grabber. Don't try to grab a hold of it. Yes, I got it, and yes, I don't have it. I both have it and do not have it. I both have it and do not have it. Wow, it's getting dark so much earlier now. It's just unbelievable. It seemed like just a few days ago it was like 8:30, it was still light, and now it's 8:12. I mean, it's amazing how quickly it changed. The gradualism just seemed to disappear. It seems quite, you know, quite dark now. Well, maybe the gradualism will disappear in the world also. But be of good cheer. Be of good cheer. We have the technique, the practice that is required. That is effective. That is effective. And I've been testing this out, testing it out, testing it out. I want another challenge to test it out even more so. So you can put it this way, let the one who knows that this practice is right and effective and just, let that one show up. And the other ones who might be offended by us saying, well, I know this is the great teacher, and I also know this is not the great teacher. Those who would be offended by that, don't show up. To make it very simple, don't show up. In fact, absolutely, I don't want anyone who would be offended by this to show up. Absolutely not. But I do absolutely want one who would be not offended in the slightest bit by this to show up. because I'll say, well, this is how I'm going to be practicing, you know. So you better not be offended in the slightest bit. Otherwise, don't show up. This might be the last hot day of the year, at least here. It's too bad. I would like to have this days like every day like this. Very much on fire today. It's a fiery day. Bug, bug, bug. All day been elated and fired up. But I was in control. I was composed. I could do this practice. Now I knew if I drank an energy drink of some sort, I would have lost control. I was so elated and fired up that I knew. But I was, you know, the intense. Everything was so intense. I said, oh my gosh! If I was on an energy drink right now, I would start snapping in these various ways. I might have snapped at people, and you know. So it's super. Realize that the intensity that we're under right now is so extreme that you don't dare have artificial substances in your body. You know that. Will push you over the edge. I had a couple situations today. Pretty amazing situations. I'm in a grocery store. And I have a bunch of groceries, and I have them on the conveyor belt. And this man, I noticed this man walking back and forth, and he was mentally disturbed, to say the least. He was talking out loud in gibberish, or repeating himself over and over, and just, you know, his actions were someone who was very mentally disturbed. And he got a soft drink with caffeine and a Coke, a type of Coke, you know, cola, a cup of cola drink. And that's all he got. And then he got in line behind me, and he's moving around weird ways and talking to himself and repeating. And I said, wow. Okay, well, and then I looked at him. I said, "You only have one thing," and I said, "I just treated him like he's a normal person." I said, "You only have one item, and you know, I got many. You know, V, why don't you go in front of me? Go ahead and go in front of me." He goes, "Ah," you know, he kind of, "Yeah." He was just, his whole mind was dissociated. He had severe dissociative problems, and then so he went in front of me, and then I saw he had a backpack on it, and it's riding his bike. And I said, "Hey, it's a hot day today. He's riding your bike." He said, "Hey, I lost my car. I lost my car. Lost my car." And then he kept repeating, "He'd be quiet for a while. Hey, I lost my car. I lost my car. I lost my car. Got no choice. Got no choice." I said, "Oh, okay. Wow. Okay. Well, stay cool. You know." So, at the end, I almost missed it, but I just barely caught it out of the corner of my eye. After he had finished checking out and he was moving off, he kind of looked at me and said, "Hey, thanks." He sort of nodded at me like, "Thanks," you know. He acknowledged, you know, me letting him go through. So, you know, he had an expressive dysfunctionality there. But, you know, I just treated him like, well, you know, you're just the same as me with ourself. It's just the same. We have the same self, you know. It's this perfect, flawless self. You just have there's some blockages, you know, going on with you. And also, by doing that, I sidestepped his disturbance by letting him go in front of me, and he was then gone. And then I, you know, took me quite some time to do the groceries, this and that, and it took a while. And this sweet little lady came in behind me from some foreign country, I don't know what, and she was so nice. I gave her the bar that separates our groceries, you know, and she says, "Oh, thank you so much, Sarah, don't you? Thank you so much." And it's like, she's like so sweet and prayerful. It's amazing. You know, she was able to express gratitude. Express gratitude. This little old lady, but very petite and small from some foreign country. She had some foreign accent like this. She said, "Oh, thank you so much, sir." You know, and I just did the littlest thing possible. You know, she couldn't reach it, you know, and I just, "Oh, here it is," and I just put it there. It's nothing. But she was like so grateful for it, you know. So her ability to express was very extreme, whereas this guy who had mental blockages, he has extreme problems expressing, and yet he was still able to give me a nod and say and mumble, you know, thanks, like that, you know. So it's still there. See, it's there within him. It's there within him. It's within everybody. Now, another experience, I had to unload, do some, I had some, basically it was an experience where a bunch of loose insulation got unloaded right beside me. The wind blew it right into my face, all my hair and face and eyes, and it kept doing this like a snowstorm of loose insulation, and I breathed in a whole lot of it, and these guys were, there's so more. I said, holy cow, I got to get out of this. And I just walked away from the situation. And I said, I can't do my work right now. I'm just going to wait for them to leave. I just have to wait for them to leave. Even now my throat is sore. And, you know, I unfortunately got a lot, you know, I didn't quite realize what was going on at first. Wasn't paying clear enough attention, so it happened. But I caught it, and I said, whoa, no, what do I do, what do I do, what do I do? Do I just be like an idiot and just stay here and just take it like this? Or I said, just walk away. And I walked away, and I told the guy in charge, I said, hey, look. He noticed. He said, sorry. Yeah, I understand what's going on. Yeah, you know, he was totally okay to stay out of it. He's totally okay, the boss, the situation. He says, my mistake. I should have put them somewhere else. That you're getting clobbered by this. Real bad. So I just waited out of the picture. I just got out of the picture, stayed away from the situation until they were finished and gone. And then I went back and took care of my business. So this shows a lot of maturity, you know, and a spiritual message is this situation in the world could very likely become extremely terrible. Imagine if you're just in a snowstorm of insulation, loose insulation, someone had torn out of a house. It's getting in your eyes. I mean, my eyes hurt. You're breathing it. It's all of your skin, your clothes, your vehicle, everything. You know, what do you do? You just say, oh, you just keep following the narratives, like because the narrative of authority is telling you that this is what you just have to bear. There's no other option. You don't have any other option. And I said, the heck with that. You know, I didn't know what the guy in charge is going to say. But, you know, whatever he's going to say, I say, well, you know, guess what? I'm not going back there. Deal with it. But just the opposite. He saw I took assertive move. And I said, you know, and he said, hey, I totally understand. Absolutely. Not a problem at all. No issue whatsoever. You know, it's just common sense, you know? What I did was just common sense. And here's somebody. He's not some academic or intellectual person, just a salt of the earth. He's just common sense, of course. You just use your common sense. What the heck? You know? What's wrong with common sense under circumstances like that? Don't be an idiot and just think that you're stuck in the situation. So a lot of what's happening right now around the world and in the United States in particular, I'm saying, it's just common sense. It's all just common sense. You can't continue to have some stuff going on that's just, you know, going to be disastrous. It's ridiculous. So, and yet, the ones that were doing this, they were just, you know, they didn't care at all. They didn't care at all. They had no common sense. I don't want to say who they were, but let's just say that they were sort of robotic and didn't quite understand that in our culture, this culture we have, you know, you notify people, like, you know, if you're going to be unloading a bunch of insulation, you might say, hey, you know, I could see, oh, it's blowing right in your face. Hey, you know, sorry, you know, maybe, you know, could you move out of the way or you know, maybe I need to move somewhere else. I mean, you know, common sense. No, they're just, it's their job. They're just doing as fast as they can. And you know, I think they felt too intimidated to even say anything to me, you know, that this is a problem. And people are good all over. Everyone's good in some way. A lot of times they feel they couldn't approach me because they felt maybe I have, you know, too much status, and they're very low status people, and you know, they don't know what to say. You know, they might lose face. I don't know, whatever it is, cultural thing. You know, this is not good. It's not good. You know, being straightforward, just being straightforward and feeling you have a right to be straightforward with people, they have a right to be straightforward with you, is absolutely essential for a positive culture. Absolutely essential. As straightforwardness is very essential. We don't have that anymore in the world. It's been, you know, it's just like very few people can be that way. When someone's straightforward with us, we just like, wow, this is quite astonishing. On the other hand, I have a lot of experience with people who have no education whatsoever here in this country, and they have a lot of common sense. And they see something, the problem, say, oh, yeah, of course, I see what's going on. What's wrong with common sense? They haven't been trained in PC, you know, we're not supposed to have common sense. And so they say, you know, and get along great. You know, you're straightforward with me, I'm straightforward with you. Common sense. Have a great day. You know, very positive. So I saw that these people were oblivious to the situation. They weren't going to stop. They weren't going to change and nothing, you know. And so I said, well, okay, I'm going to get out of the way. I'm just going to get out of the way until they're finished and done with it and out of here. So this is sort of a metaphor for the world right now, is that this PC-ness, lack of common sense, It's got deeper roots than we realize. It really does. And there's so many people here who feel like they're like just cannot be straightforward about it and speak truth to the situation. And they're just going to continue like robotically on with the narrative. They say, this is the narrative we've told. We got to follow the narrative. You know, we got to follow the narrative. See? Now, back to Trump, he's saying, hey, I don't like this narrative. I'm not going to follow it. Well, we don't have to necessarily follow his narrative. A lot of people don't like his narrative, so they say. But the more important issue is we realize, hey, wait a minute. If he can stand up and say, I'm not going to follow your narrative, maybe we can stand up and say also, hey, I'm not going to follow your narrative. Maybe he won't even follow yours either. But the principle says we don't have to follow, you know, necessarily follow a narrative if we don't want to. If somebody's, you know, forcing like insulation down our throats, do we have to follow that narrative? Like I'm just worthless, so whether I, you know, get insulation shoved down my throat or not, it's just my fate. Too bad, you know, too bad for me. No. You see, I don't have to follow that narrative. I deserve better. I deserve better than that. So, you get somebody saying, hey, we deserve better. We deserve better than the narrative. The narrative that we're hearing now, we deserve better than that. Very important to hear that. We deserve better than that. Now, we may not like their ideas, or some like some and not like others, whatever. But the principle is, hey, it's okay to feel that you deserve better than the narrative that you're living under. This is what John the Baptist told people, you know, you deserve better. You deserve to be born again, free of the past. You know, your sins are washed away, free of the past. You don't have to be held to the narrative of the past. This is what the baptism is about. You don't have to be held imprisoned by the narrative of the past. And of course, Jesus came and says, you are. We're all the eternal now. We are eternal life right now. And there is no past. In fact, the past has just been a pretense on our part. But first John the Baptist came and said, you don't have to be held bondage by the narrative of the past. Let your sins can be washed away, and you can be this new person, no longer encumbered by the past. And we're having a similar situation right now in the United States, is people are quite astonished. Now, some are just laughing and mocking it, say, this guy's a complete buffoon. It's, you know, well, fine. But the bottom line is we don't have to follow, we don't necessarily have to follow this PC narrative. Which is that we're always the bad guys, and you know the criminals are the good guys, so to speak. This is ultimately the narrative: is that the good people are really the criminals, and the criminals are really the good people. You know that you know we deserve to be victimized by thug culture and stuff. This is the underlying narrative, which is designed to make everybody sick. You know, it's like a lose-lose narrative that we're actually being forced down our throats. Lose-lose narrative. So we're all stressed out and we're all sick, which benefits what? The greatest industry in the world, with nothing even in close. Healthcare industry, pharmaceutical industry, et cetera, et cetera, et cetera. I'll make sure it's not an emergency here. Okay, it's not. Okay, I can just deal with that easily. But just a quick message. So, they want, literally, I know this is like a terrible thing to say, and this is what they count on, is nobody has the guts to accuse them of this, okay? Because then they think, well, you must be crazy, because nobody would be this terrible. This is how they hide. This is how the ego hides. The ego is so terrible that to point out how terrible it is, you seem like you're crazy. Because nothing, you say, nothing could be that terrible. Nothing could be so conspiratorial. It's impossible. You must be a nutcase, you know. This is what the ego counts on. It absolutely counts on this. And this is their secret to those in who've gotten to great positions of power in this world, politically, etc., is they're actually so bad that you can't even point out how bad they are, because people think that you're being really fanatical and crazy about it, you know. And so it's very stressful to point out that, you know, just how bad it is, because this dynamic's in place. Okay. So when we say that this healthcare industry and the pharmaceutical industries have this stranglehold on the world, and they want to maintain it, and they're doing everything in their power to do so, and the roots of it go deeper than that. Ultimately, it's designed for us to believe that mortal mind is true, it's our reality, it's our identity, and there isn't anything else on the